All right, well, thank you very much. We appreciate the opportunity to speak to the long-term care population of folks, and we're certainly very interested in making sure that you all have your questions answered. We do recognize that many people have varying levels of understanding about regional care organizations, and we want to try to acknowledge that a little bit in this presentation. Some of you may be very familiar with RCOs, and others of you may not be familiar at all. And part of the attempt in this presentation is to level set a bit, to not necessarily go into every detail about RCOs, that would take a long time, but to level set a bit in terms of some baseline understanding. But then at the end, we really want to fine tune this particular presentation toward some questions that we have received from the long-term care community. So you'll see that at the end. But in the beginning, we'll provide more general information about regional care organizations that hopefully will be helpful to you. So we'll dive right on in, just so we'll have a little more time at the end for questions. The first slide I want to talk to you about is this more general slide. It has a couple of statements on it that seem simple, but they are not simple. They actually include a variety of concepts and ideas that are important to understanding regional care organizations. So let's sort of dive into that in these simple statements because they grow out of the work that was done by the governor's task force and ultimately the legislature and the governor himself in terms of the laws that were set forth directing the Medicaid agency to develop regional care organizations. So the first sentence says, RCOs are locally led managed care organizations that will provide services for Medicaid enrollees at an established cost when the program is implemented in October of 2016. There are a few key words in here that are very meaningful. One, obviously, RCOs, regional care organizations. Well, the definition of regional is just that, regional. These organizations typically are focused on a given region in the state, and we're going to look at the regions in just a moment. As opposed to a single organization being statewide, these organizations, although they may be represented in multiple regions, the work they do in a region is focused on that region, and that is a key word in this statement. Locally led, part of the concept behind this whole program was that the organizations would be led or have boards that were consisted of many individuals or provider types from the actual specific region that was involved. So they are locally led in that regard. They are managed care in the sense of receiving a capitated payment for a set of services and being at risk. One of the key concepts that the legislature hoped to obtain in this process was to have organizations that would share risk with the state for the care of Medicaid populations. And you'll see that actually in the program as we talk more about the details that are involved in how it operates. So risk is a key component, and that is achieved in the way these organizations are set up. The second statement equally is a loaded statement. Lots of words in there that mean very important concepts for this entire program. So when you talk about certified RCOs, assuming risk, again the word risk, as I've already talked about, certified RCOs will assume the risk of managing the full cost of covered Medicaid services and care coordination for most Medicaid recipients. Let's sort of tease that sentence apart also. First being certified. Today, we don't have any RCOs. Today, what we have are probationary RCOs. There is a difference. Probationary RCOs are in the process of going through the key hoops that are necessary to become fully certified RCOs. What are those key hoops? We're going to look at them in detail in just a minute, but just to give you the broad outlines, the first one that we think about is identified in the law as the requirements around service delivery network. There are requirements that the RCOs be able to provide an adequate number of providers to take care of the populations that they have assigned to them. So this concept of being certified partly involves having an adequate service delivery network. Another key requirement is that of financial solvency. All of the probationary RCOs have now demonstrated their ability to have the money that is required by the law to be able to participate in this process. bottom line is, do you have enough money to be part of this, to play in this sort of area? And in all of the probationary RCOs have demonstrated that, as all of the probationary RCOs have demonstrated the ability to form an adequate service delivery network. So those first two hoops, at this point, they've all gotten over. The third hoop is that about proving that they can pass a readiness review, where the agency and even the federal government, CMS, looks at, can they actually do what they say they can do? Can they actually pay bills? Can they actually case manage? Can they actually operate a system or not? Obviously, that has to be determined in a very real review. And that readiness review is the third step, and we're in the process of doing the readiness review even now with, at this point, a desk review, but soon will be actual on-site reviews to look at the particular organizations and how they do what they do. So that one word of certified, when it says certified RCOs, that's a very loaded word and very important word in this process. So certified RCOs will assume the risk of managing the full cost of covered services and care coordination. There are certain services that are the responsibility of the RCOs, as there are certain populations that are the responsibility of the RCOs, but there are other services that are not. And that's particularly important for long-term care providers, and we'll be talking about that in just a moment in a little more detail. So, what were some of the other concepts behind this process when the legislature asked the Medicaid agency to develop RCOs? What were some of the things they were looking at? Well, obviously, again, it's a managed care program. It's operated under a capitated payment. They did ask us to do it through regional care. So all of those are key words in this process. It also mentions a little bit about how they would begin to modify the delivery of services. Case management has been available only in a limited scope for broader populations of Medicaid over time, and it's been a bit of a patchwork. This system will actually tie that together, where case management will be available for more broad populations and more consistently across the state. Also, there will be the particulars around medical home and health homes that currently operated through the Patient First program or Health Home program. The requirements that exist in those programs, many of the same features of those requirements will remain the same in the regional care organizations, but they will be conducted by the regional care organizations rather than the current methodologies that we use in Medicaid. Most Medicaid recipients will be included. When you look at Medicaid populations and look at who's in and who's out, most people are in terms of the numbers. Occasionally, I do get questions where I'm asked, well, RCOs are fine, but I really don't want to have anything to do with them. I just want to keep on seeing Medicaid folks the same way I have been. And what we typically tell physicians are the ones we typically get that question from. And for most physicians that are out there, that's fine. No one's going to force them to do RCOs. However, most of the patients actually will be in the RCOs. So I think that's what you're going to see going forward. Approximately 650 to 700,000 of the million or so clients that depend on Medicaid for coverage are actually in the RCOs, although, again, very pertinent to long-term care. Most of the populations that you deal with in terms of the dual eligibles and others are out, and we'll look a little more at that in just a bit. Okay, we'll move on to the next slide and talk a little bit about quality and the impact of quality. Quality is important in this program in many ways, but particularly it was stressed by the federal government. In the approval of our waiver, they intentionally built in quality metrics and tied money in the waiver to performance on certain metrics so that that would be an incentive for the state. Well, obviously, that incentive would be passed down from the state to the regional care organizations and then subsequently from the regional care organizations on into the providers that they work with. So quality is not just an afterthought, it's actually a very primary driver in this system, which is different, and there is an emphasis placed upon that in a different way from what exists in the current program today. It also makes mention of this phrase of a philosophical change from a system that's really based on visits and volume to one that's focused more on outcomes and quality. Today, you get paid more if you do more. The concept behind managed care is that you get a better reimbursement if you provide higher quality, which higher quality does not necessarily mean unbridled utilization. It actually means appropriate utilization. Sometimes that's more utilization. Sometimes that's less utilization. But finding the right level of utilization to help you achieve the quality outcomes necessary, that's the goal. So it is very different in the sense of not necessarily just rewarding more visits, but actually rewarding quality and outcome. So measurement will be very important in this world going forward. And one of the requirements in the RCO legislation is that we do have various types of quality metrics that represent different domains of quality, and that we actually share them publicly. So you will see information about how the RCOs have performed in achieving these various quality metrics. So we'll go on to the next slide. And this slide actually exists on our website, and you can see it maybe perhaps a little larger even on our website, or you can blow it up however you would like. But the map that you see demonstrates the five regions of the state. Obviously, the state had to be divided up into regions to achieve regional care. The law directed it that way. And anywhere you would draw a line on a map to develop a region, you'd probably cross over a typical care pattern for someone. But there was a very real attempt made back in 2013 when this map was constructed to try to respect current care patterns, and particularly looking at hospital systems and sort of typical referral methodologies to try to not impact any more of those typical care patterns than had to be. Well, obviously, again, anywhere you draw a line would cause some crossing of a care pattern, and we know that. But as you can see, the areas are fairly large, and they do respect fairly large areas of capture for typical services. Also on this map, you see an outline of who the probationary RCOs are and who many of their financial backers are in terms of what they're trying to do and how they're trying to actually build and construct their business. And we'll move on to the next slide. I mentioned this just a bit earlier. Again, the three big hoops in terms of moving from being a probationary RCO to being a fully certified RCO. The initial hoop in terms of the adequacy, the service delivery network, a very important hoop to get through. They had to prove the ability to form an adequate network. They've done that now. So the 11 probationary RCOs have passed that. Doesn't mean everybody's where they need to be with fully developed networks. As a matter of fact, nearly all of them still have gaps to fill in that process, but they've all shown that they do have the ability to form a network, which we'll be looking for more carefully in the process of full certification in the readiness review. The second hoop mentioned here, again, in the law was around the financial solvency requirements. They've gone through that hoop, and as I said earlier, they're now in the readiness review process, and we're looking carefully at them in terms of seeing how what they've proposed complies with the law and federal statutes and the proposed contract between Medicaid and the regional care organizations. The next slide looks a little bit more specifically in terms of covered populations to look at who's in and who's out. In this situation, it may be actually easier to think about who's out. Dual eligibles, those with Medicare and Medicaid, are not under the responsibility of the RCOs. Foster children are out. Hospice patients are out. And you'll see the others that are listed there to give you a little bit of a concept of who's out. So who's in typically is who you think of in terms of sort of the general population of outpatient care that goes on. Obviously, our Patient First program, which has been the bailiwick of the Medicaid program for a good while now, the maternity program is in. So the system of maternity contractors that we have today will go away. Currently, the RCOs are scheduled to be implemented on October the 1st. So the last day the maternity contractors would operate as we know them today would be currently is planned for September 30th. And their roles and their responsibilities will be transferred to the RCO. So the same kinds of activities will occur, but they're going to be done by the larger, more broad organization that's out there. It mentions here, too, these other groups in terms of ABDs, the Breast and Cervical Treatment Program, the MLIF. So again, that gives you a little bit of a feel of who's in. Again, Remember, most Medicaid clients are in terms of the general population of Medicaid, but not necessarily most of the clients for long-term care. In fact, quite the opposite. Now, let's talk a bit about services. Which services are in and which ones are out. It mentions here primarily the ones that are in. Hospital care, inpatient and outpatient hospital care, emergency room, physician care, primary care, specialty care, those kinds of things are in. The federally qualified health centers, the rural health clinics, those are in. Lab, mental behavioral health are in, including the community mental health centers. Substance abuse treatments are currently not in and actually will be scheduled to be brought in at a later date, and we'll talk about that in just a bit. Again, eye care, maternity, again, is mentioned, and then some of the transportation services will be the responsibilities of the RCO. Pharmacy, although it is, and obviously will continue to be a Medicaid covered service, it is not actually under the responsibility of the RCOs. The pharmacy program will continue to be managed at the state level, which is great in the sense of some consistency across the program and across the state, and that will continue to be in that way. Now, important for this group, it specifically mentions that long-term care and dental services are excluded. And that is certainly true, and many of you in the long-term care world are familiar with the integrated care networks that are currently planned, also state law directing their development. They're on a separate track, separate process, not the RCOs, but we'll talk about some of the specific questions we have and how do you actually implement some of the payment today and even on October 1 of this year, so that there is a little more clarity between what the RCOs will pay and what Medicaid will pay directly. As it mentions also, substance abuse is deferred. The current plan is that substance abuse treatments would come in 2 years after the implementation of the RCOs. And then it goes on to describe just services in general. So let's look at some other keys. As it says here, claims will typically be filed with and paid by the RCOs. Fee-for-service claims and claims for people not in the RCO will continue to be filed to HPE. Again, this is particularly important in the long-term care world. It does mention that many decisions previously made by Medicaid will now be the RCO's responsibility. It's very common in our live provider meetings that we've had, and some of you may have been at some of those provider meetings, that we get a question asked to us that in the future in the RCO world is really not a Medicaid question anymore. It's now an RCO question. And typically in our live meetings, we've had the regional care organizations for that region to be present with us. And typically when we get those kinds of questions, we direct it to them and they answer. What are their plans? How will they manage things like EPSDT? How will they manage the referral process? Will they have limitations on the number of physician visits? Those kinds of things. So more and more, questions become RCO questions and less Medicaid questions. And that's an important distinction to see because for those that are more involved with the RCOs and their populations are more involved with the RCOs, they do need to begin to see that change in relationship between what has been just a binary relationship between a provider and Medicaid to a relationship that also involves the RCO. And in fact, many questions will be RCO questions going forward. For example, the referral forms and the processes around referrals likely would be different in the RCO world as opposed to how they exist today in Medicaid. It does specifically point out here the Patient First program would end on September the 30th of 2016. So the typical mechanisms of operation for Patient First will go away. Now, some of those may be retained, some of the features may be retained by the RCOs. Certainly the contract between Medicaid and the RCOs does require them to assign clients to a primary care physician. That part will be the same. But exactly how do you do a referral? How do you write out various types of prior authorizations? All of that could see significant change. It mentions here that the hospitals will be moving to this, it says global value-based payment system. The APRDRG system is by and large what will be used, or something that is similar will be used. Maybe in specific situations it might be a little bit different. Again, it mentions monitoring. The agency will be doing more monitoring of the program as opposed to so much of the managing of the program and so as the prior authorization processes and that sort of thing. But the monitoring will be significantly more. There's a great deal of reporting due to the federal government to actually adequately monitor this program. Right, we'll move on to the next slide, and it talks a little bit more about prior authorizations and referrals. A couple of key things in this, though, that is, when it says provider contracts must be approved by Medicaid, certainly they don't mean every single word of those contracts, but there are key provisions that the attorneys are expecting to see in the contracts between the RCOs and providers that have to be approved by Medicaid. It does say that providers must contract with at least one RCO in order to be paid for services, but they could contract with multiple RCOs. Again, that is for services for clients that are in the RCO responsibility. So if you are not contracting with an RCO as a provider and you see clients that are an RCO responsibility, then it would probably be to your advantage to work out some sort of contract or agreement with them. The law does make a couple of specific requirements, one being the any willing provider requirement. If a provider is willing to meet the terms and conditions of a contract offered to similarly situated providers, then the RCO has to offer them a contract. That's a requirement that's in the law. So that is certainly respected in the contract between Medicaid and the RCOs, and that will be an ongoing feature. The other key feature that's established in the law is the fee-for-service minimum. The law does require that what's the least I could be paid? Well, the least you could be paid would be the prevailing fee-for-service rate. Now, prevailing does not necessarily mean what is prevailing today, as it does mean what is prevailing at the time of the actual engagement with the RCO. So, that might change as our budget changes and that sort of thing, but the prevailing fee-for-service rate will be important for many providers who do contract with the RCOs to provide services. Again, I think I've mentioned several of these other things, but the last bullet is important in the sense of the prior authorizations and referrals cannot be any more restrictive than the current prior authorization and referral processes that Medicaid uses unless it is approved by Medicaid. So we would have to have Medicaid would have to review it and see that there would be value in whatever is being proposed and approve that before an RCO could implement anything that would be more restrictive. Let's talk a little bit about the assignment process. Maybe not as pertinent for this particular audience, but just so you can hear what other providers have heard, a big question for the primary care physicians is, how do I keep my panel of patients? You know, how do I maintain that group? Well, again, as I said earlier, there is a changing relationship between most providers and Medicaid that now also involves the RCOs. That's certainly true in the assignment of patients. The assignment of patients becomes a two-step process. The primary part that Medicaid controls and works with is getting clients assigned from Medicaid roles down to a specific RCO. The RCOs will be part of controlling the process between having their group of patients in their RCO, but getting them assigned to the level of the specific primary care providers. And they will have flexibility in terms of managing those panel sizes and that sort of thing. So that's a very key difference in this. The last patient first assignment, in other words, the sort of assignment that we've been making for a long time now, will actually be during August of this year for the September assignments. Remember, October 1 would be when the RCOs would start. There won't be a patient first program. So the patient first assignment come October 1 wouldn't matter because that requirement would then be on the RCOs. Now, for the RCOs, the initial enrollment process working up toward that October 1 start date actually begins in July with the enrollment broker, which is a contractor that Medicaid has hired to actually reach out to clients to help inform them about their choices. If they have two or more RCOs in a region, here's what those RCOs cover, and here are the providers that each of those RCOs have, and to provide a non-biased way of helping the client to actually make a choice between the RCOs, because the ultimate decider, the most powerful decision maker in which RCO do I go to is the patient. The first step in this is patient choice. it is the predominant step. It will overrule any other step in the process. If a patient chooses to go to RCOA, they go to RCOA. If a patient chooses to go to RCOB, they go to RCOB. So the patient has the ultimate control over this until they get locked in, which is after a 90-day period. During their first 90 days of being on the RCO program, they actually can change from one RCO to the other. Again, their choice. But they will have that 90 days. But after that 90 days, they're then locked in for the remainder of that year. So that the remaining 9 months, we'll say if they waited until the last day to make a change, the remaining 9 months would be with one RCO, and they wouldn't have another chance to change until they're getting ready for the next year, the coming up year. So that will be important because the RCOs obviously need some stable patient base to be able to operate their business, but to also be able to focus on how do I drive and improve quality. If I don't have a client for very long, I don't have an opportunity to do that, so that will be important. Of course, another key part in this is, well, what if the patient doesn't make a choice? Well, then there is a process for doing that and making the choice, auto-assigning them. But the next step in this is looking at what has been their clinical history. You know, where have they typically been to the doctor? Which doctors seem to be more pertinent based on their number of visits and the relationship and the problems they've had to their care? We want to try to respect that as much as possible. It may be that their typical cadre of doctors is more represented in one RCO versus the other. And so the second step in the process would respect that and would try to get them with their typical cadre of physicians that would take care of them. Then we get into other factors such as where is the rest of their family at and other factors we'll be looking at. So just be aware there is a process, and then this next slide sort of graphically shows you the two-step process to this. Again, Medicaid primarily controls the first part, getting folks assigned to an RCO. But then the RCO will control how do I get you all the way down to a primary care doctor. And if this were a primary care talk, we'd focus more on those bottom circles, but we won't do that for the sake of this discussion. We'll actually move on to the next slide and begin to look at some of the long-term care questions. So I'm going to read these to try to be a little more precise in my answers and to help as we go along, and then we'll get to the open Q&A section. So if there's something that's still not clear, certainly you can ask, and either I can give you the answer or we'll find someone who can and may have to get the answer to you later. But the first question that we had ahead of time, if the nursing home placement will be coordinated by the RCO but paid by Medicaid, would a contract with the RCO be required in order for the nursing home to take that patient and be paid by Medicaid? The short answer is that a contract would not be required with the RCO because Medicaid will be paying those particular services. So that is a very clear distinction in terms of what other providers typically deal with the RCOs versus what a nursing home would deal with. If an RCO care coordinator is making arrangements for nursing home care and will continue to follow the patient during the nursing home stay, will a contract with the RCO be required in order for the nursing home to be able to take the resident even though the RCO will not be paying for the resident's care? And again, a pretty straightforward answer, a contract is not required in that situation. Our next slide, whether an individual is simply a RCO member or one of the patients who is being managed by the RCO more closely due to certain medical conditions. If he or she enters a nursing home, does he or she have a choice to remain in or leave the RCO upon admission to the nursing home? And if so, how does the individual withdraw from the RCO? Well, bottom line is the individual stays a member of the RCO for the first 90 days. Now, if they come into the nursing home, they're there less than 90 days, they never stop being in the RCO. However, the nursing home payment, again, still comes directly from Medicaid. The client is an RCO client, but the payment to the nursing home comes directly from Medicaid, unless the stay goes over 90 days. Once you go over 90 days, then they are automatically rotated out of the RCO, and it sort of goes back to what you typically experience today. Next question says, an individual enters a nursing home which is outside his or her current RCO region, does the resident or the nursing home have to take any action to ensure that the individual can receive uninterrupted Medicaid services? And of course, the answer is no, neither the resident nor the nursing home will have to take any action. as long as it's less than 90 days, the RCO will still have some responsibilities in this, but the client and the nursing home themselves will not have to take any action. Next, if someone is in a RCO, will they be handled like individuals who are in patient first? Currently, nursing homes have to get them out of patient first in order to get paid, especially if the resident is from another county. The answer, again, to be specific, the Patient First program will end on October 1, actually September 30th of 2016. If an RCO member enters the nursing home for a short-term stay, 90 days or less, they will remain in the RCO, and the RCO will be responsible for payment of those services that are covered by the RCO. Again, nursing home services are out of that. Nursing homes will continue to bill directly to Medicaid since this service is not covered by the RCO. For a long-term stay, over 90 days, the client will no longer be assigned to an RCO. Nursing homes have been getting requests to enroll with RCOs. Should they be enrolled? Well, again, long-term care services are not included in the RCOs. So it says here you should not be getting a request to enroll with an RCO as far as payment. Now, an RCO may want you to be available to help them as they care coordinate and to be engaged with them at that level. But that's different from a payment situation. So the next slide, for the individual who receives SSI and Social Security with no Medicare and who is in an RCO, enters a nursing home for a long-term stay to exceed 90 days, the usual process to continue Medicaid eligibility for such an individual would be to apply for Medicaid through the district office. Will the RCO affect this process in any way? And the bottom line is no, the RCO will not affect this process. Determining eligibility is still an agency function like it is an agency function today, and the enrollment or the engagement with SSI and those other parts of this don't change. So the establishment of eligibility is not an RCO process. Getting them enrolled with the RCO is part of what Medicaid does, and then the RCOs will take folks from that point going forward to the other things that we've already talked about. If someone is in a health home with the RCO and an illness causes them to need temporary nursing home care, will the RCO health home case manager make arrangements for nursing home care, and will the RCO or Medicaid pay the nursing home? The RCO health home care coordinator will assist in making arrangements for nursing home care. Medicaid will reimburse the nursing home. So again, that same principle continues to hold true. And then this is our last page of prepared Q&As. It says, an individual enters a nursing home which is outside his or her current RCO region, does the resident nursing home have to take any action to ensure that the individual can receive uninterrupted Medicaid service? So again, the same type of question. Neither the RCO or the nursing home will have to take any action. And then lastly, frequently an individual from one county goes to a nursing home in another county. What happens when the resident is assigned to an RCO physician in his region, but will need to use the physician who serves the nursing home, which is located in another region? What does the resident have to do in relation to the RCO to ensure that he or she can be seen by the physician serving that nursing home? Again, let me read this answer. For a short-term stay, 90 days or less, they will remain in the RCO, and the RCO will be responsible for payment of those services covered by the RCO, except for nursing home services. Each RCO is responsible for providing services to a short-term stay client through a physician. So the RCO will be responsible to make sure that those physician services are still able to be provided. If the physician is not contracted with the RCO the recipient is assigned to, the physician will need to contact the RCO to discuss payment arrangements. Obviously, you preferably would do this ahead of time. For a long-term stay over 90 days, the client would no longer be assigned to the RCO. So they would be out. In over 90 days, the RCO would no longer be responsible for payment to anyone for that particular client. Okay, and then our last slide I want to touch base with, and then we'll open it up to questions and answers. The last slide really is a depiction of the Medicaid website. And the reason why we like to point this out is because we could do a webinar for 12 hours and not cover everything. I'm not sure I could do one for 12 hours, but it could be done for 12 hours. to cover many other things about RCOs. Well, rather than doing that, you can actually go on our website and find lots and lots of information. Obviously, in the bottom left-hand corner, there's an icon about RCOs. If you click on that, it'll take you to the RCO page, and you will see dozens and dozens and dozens of documents that have been posted there describing various aspects of the RCO program, including pretty elaborate matrices that show which populations are in and out of the RCOs and which services are in and out of the RCOs, but lots of other documents, including a large document about questions and answers that have been submitted. The last time I looked, we were over 200 questions and answers that were posted in those documents, where many of the questions you have probably have already been asked before at some level, and you can look through that and see some already detailed answers that have been developed. And then lastly, it mentions here the RCO portal in terms of you being able to submit questions in the same way others have for the agency to take in, develop more detailed answers, and be able to push them back out via the website. So that link is listed, obviously, toward the bottom of this particular page or depiction of the website. So again, don't hesitate to send questions because we've gotten many. But I would encourage you to look at the questions we've already gotten, because there are many aspects of the program that have already been sort of vetted out in terms of questions and answers that might answer a question that you have. So with that, I will stop here and open the floor to questions. So I'll turn it back to the operator.
We have a question from the line of Dan Kessler, Disability Rights. Please go ahead.
Good afternoon.
Hi.
I have a question regarding discharge planning for those individuals who are in, those Medicaid patients who are in nursing homes for less than 90 days. Will that be the responsibility of the RCO or the responsibility of the nursing home staff?
The shortest answer would be both, in the sense of certainly we would expect there to be coordination of care. I mean, obviously the client is still in the RCO, so their case manager will be important in that process and will be important in identifying and sort of helping arrange for services. But we also respect and understand the nursing homes and their sort of typical role in those situations. So we will, there are lots of other situations out there. Let me give another example. Community mental health centers, they have case managers. Well, we don't ask the RCO or even today the health home managers to be duplicative in the services that they provide. They coordinate with the community mental health centers to make sure everything is taken care of, and I would expect that we would see something similar in this situation.
We have a question from the line of Liz Hammond, HCS. Please go ahead.
Thank you so much. I'm still a little bit confused about those people who cross over borders, and let me give you my example. Someone from Clark County is in an RCO there and uses Grove Hill Hospital and Dr. Jones. He goes to a nursing home in Wilcox County, which is served by J. Paul Jones Hospital and Dr. Smith. When he is discharged from the nursing home to the hospital, it's going to be J. Paul Jones. So is J. Paul Jones Hospital, even though they're in a different region, going to have to contract with his current RCO?
Again, for clients that have been in the nursing home less than 90 days, the answer would be yes, because they will have to be able to provide services. The RCO is ultimately responsible for seeing that the client gets services. So it will be on the RCO to make sure that's available. Now maybe it's available on a specific service case agreement, a case service agreement for that individual client, but maybe it's a broader contract where the RCO has an interest in having an ongoing contract with that hospital. And frankly, we've seen many of the RCOs to work to reach out to many of the hospitals that are not even in their regions to go ahead and establish contracts. And I expect we'll see that even more as we go forward. Same thing would be true for physicians. I think we're very likely to see RCOs develop contracts with physicians that are not necessarily in their regions for situations like this, or perhaps they will choose to do out single case agreements in terms of providing payment. But the payment responsibility is with the RCO that the client is assigned to. So as long as they're in the nursing home no longer than 90 days, they have to go to the nursing home is outside the region. They have to subsequently be admitted to a hospital that's outside the region. The responsibility for that care, as long as we're still in that less than 90-day window, is going to be the RCO. So they still will have that responsibility.
Will everyone who is in an RCO and who is admitted to a nursing home, for the first 90 days, will they remain in the RCO regardless of whether, what if the stay is going to be a permanent stay?
Well, the first 90 days, they will continue to be in the RCO.
Okay, and one last question, and it concerns the border areas. When we have someone who is on SSI from Georgia, and they come to a nursing home in Alabama, the process has been simply to get the address changed and it flips in the system to an Alabama resident. Who is going to assist this person? I guess that wouldn't apply because they wouldn't have to come to an RCO, get into an RCO if they were coming into a nursing home from another state, correct?
That would be correct. I mean, particularly in the situation of a dual eligible, they would not be in, even if they were in Alabama.
No, this wouldn't be dual eligible. We have lots and lots of people in the nursing homes who are not dual eligible.
I understand that. I was just trying to talk about that particular example. But in the situation you describe, what you said is correct. They would not be part of the process. Some of you may have heard about the integrated provider system and the initiatives associated with that. If you have, there is a location on our website. When you do go to the RCO page on our website, there is a link there that would take you to the integrated provider system page, which also has dozens of documents to talk about that. It's not so much focused in terms of the long-term care community, so I won't spend a lot of time there, but if you have heard IPS or integrated provider system and you have questions about it, I would encourage you to go to that page on our website to read and learn more. Certainly we appreciate this opportunity, and these other webinars that we've done relative to RCOs have been recorded and placed on our website, so you can actually go back and look at a couple of others that are very similar to this and many others that cover other aspects of this. I would encourage you to do that to learn more about RCOs. So thank you again for today, and we'll call this webinar to a close. Thank you very much.